Good afternoon. I'm Nathan W. Bingham, the Senior Manager of Communications at Ligonier Ministries, and thank you for joining us this afternoon for this afternoon's interview, Learning to Love the Psalms. Our guest this afternoon is a Ligonier Teaching Fellow. He's also the President at Westminster Seminary California, and he is the author of the new book and the soon-to-be-released Ligonier Teaching Series, Learning to Love the Psalms. Dr. W. Robert Godfrey, welcome.
Thank you, Nathan. It's great to be with you today.
Now, I do want to say that, you know, since releasing this book, we have received, you know, wonderful feedback. People have been really encouraged by it. I know that Dr. Sproul was encouraged reading it as I was preparing for this interview. It was really helpful for me. So firstly, I just want to say thank you for writing this book and for recording the teaching series with Ligonier.
Well, thank you. I'm really encouraged by that response. I'm not an expert on the Old Testament, but I am a longtime student of the Psalms. So I thought there were so many things on the Psalms out there that were not really helpful for most lay people. So I wrote this book very intentionally to try to be helpful, and I'm glad to hear you say you think I've succeeded at least somewhat in that.
Well, you begin your book by saying that, you know, you've always loved the Psalms. You love the Word of God, but particularly over the last few years, you found them to be, your words were profoundly engaging. What changed? What opened the Psalms for you?
Well, you know, Nathan, I was converted as a high school student in a largely psalm singing church. So I sort of got introduced to the Psalms without knowing it almost. I didn't know a lot of hymns when I was converted, and I didn't know any of the Psalms. But as I lived my life in that church, I found the Psalms just getting in my head and getting in my heart. But I, for years and years, didn't give a lot of thought to it. It was just what we did in our church. And, you know, it was good, but I didn't devote much analysis to that. I didn't examine that particularly. And then, as I say, as I began to get more interested in the Psalms, I tell in the book the little story that I was at a conference some years ago, and they were going to do an icebreaker. It was with Reformed and non-Reformed people. And so the leader of the group said, "Now I want us to go around and each of you tell me what's your favorite book of the Bible." And my initial sort of grumpy Reformed response was, well, should we have a favorite book? God wrote them all. Shouldn't we like them all equally? And then I thought I should try to be a little more cooperative and a little less grumpy. And so I thought about it for a while, and then I thought, well, maybe I ought to say Romans. That seems like the Reformed thing to do. You know, I've got to hold up the side. And then I thought, well, no, be honest. And as I thought about it, I had a few minutes to think about it. I thought it really is the Psalms that I've come to love. And so that experience then really encouraged me to think more about why do I love the Psalms, what's engaging about the Psalms, but also to think what makes the Psalms difficult for a lot of people. And so it was in exploring both my own personal attraction to the Psalms, but my own identification with what can be frustrating about the Psalms that led me to work on this book and ultimately to produce it. I think what's attractive about the Psalms is relatively easy. It's beautiful poetry, it's sentiments about God and about ourselves that are very engaging and informative and clarifying in all sorts of ways. What's difficult, I think, is a little more problematic to articulate, but part of what's difficult, I discovered for me and I think for others, is that it's often difficult to find your way around the Psalms. You find something in a Psalm that you really like, and then because most of us don't have any kind of clear outline about how the Book of Psalms is put together, it's hard then to re-find something we liked. And, you know, we probably have all been through exercises where we outline the Book of Romans. It's sin, salvation, service. It's a pretty straightforward outline. But with a Psalter, it's much more complicated. And so I try to explore these things to try to help us overcome the difficulties so that we can become more familiar with the Psalms and really learn to love them and know them.
Well, one of the reasons that I read you believe that they can be difficult to understand and to study was the shift from the use of the King James Version of the Bible to some more modern translations. How is that affected how we understand and love the Psalms?
Well, I think there were any number of phrases in the King James Version that sort of passed through generations of believers who found that phrase beautiful and arresting and comforting or challenging. And the King James Version then was a kind of poetic resource, the way Shakespeare has been a poetic resource for many people. And when the new translations came along, unintentionally, they sort of broke that chain of multi-generational appreciation of the Psalms and knowledge of the Psalms. And it's never been quite put back together again, I think. So that's another reason that the Psalms can be difficult for some reason. Also, just the knowledge of poetry, I think, has significantly declined in the last generation or two. Poetry used to be a prominent matter of study in high schools and colleges, and great poetry, both from the ancient world like Homer and Virgil, but also great English poets from Shakespeare and Milton and on, were part and parcel of education. So the people, I think, were more comfortable with poetry as a literary form than they are today. And so for people who are not exposed to poetry generally, to turn suddenly to Hebrew poetry can be kind of confusing and difficult. And that too is something I try to address in the book.
I know my wife wanted me to ask you this question. Our children memorize some of the Psalms. And as we were talking about just those thoughts on the King James Version and poetry, she wanted to know, should we be encouraging our children to memorize the Psalms in the King James Version for that poetic quality? Or is it more helpful from a teaching tool for our children to be memorizing them in the translation that they're reading at home, we're reading as a family, and hearing the preaching from in the pulpit in our local church? Just personally, from you to my wife.
Well, I tell your wife that as much as I love the King James Version, and I was still of that generation that grew up with the King James Version, I do think the language is sufficiently archaic that we probably need to shift away from the King James Version. I'm sorry, there's a phone ringing in this room.
Someone disagrees with you, and they're calling you right now.
They're calling in already, and that's fine. Actually, one of the reasons I really love the English Standard Version is that it does preserve a lot of the poetic quality of the King James Version while overcoming some of the problems with archaic language. So I think the English Standard Version is a great sort of compromise for modern readers, contemporary readers.
Well, before we move on and talk about some of the things that are to love about the Psalms, I just want to thank those that are watching live and let them know that if they would like to pick up a copy of Learning to Love the Psalms, this new book from Dr. Godfrey, that they can pick up a copy from the Ligonier online store. And for this week only, save 35% off the full list price if they use the coupon code PSALMS35. Now, I might need your help, Dr. Godfrey, to translate that. In Australia, we say Psalms. I think in America, you say it something different. How do you say Psalms?
I think we're pretty close. We say Psalms. We're not Scott saying Sams or
Sams.
Something.
Okay. So, well, that's good. Well, if they use the coupon code PSALMS35, PSALMS, the number 3 and 5, PSALMS35, during checkout from the Ligonier.org store, they can save 35% this week only off the full list price of this title. So you don't need to leave the interview right now and go and do that. I'll remind you again later on. But be sure to visit Ligonier.org and search for Learning to Love the Psalms and use that coupon code PSALMS35 for that discount. Now, it expires April 23rd, 2017.
Can I just say that I think, even at the risk of sounding like I'm hawking my own book, that I think Ligonier has done a marvelous job producing this book. It's a beautiful hardbound book and with a really readable type and beautifully published. So it's a very nice book just to hold in your hand. Even if you don't read it, it's a nice book to have.
Well, one of the things I liked, you quoted John Calvin. You quote him several times in the book, but you quote John Calvin describing the Psalter as an anatomy of all the parts of the soul. What did Calvin mean by that?
Well, what Calvin meant by that is that when you think of all the range of emotions that can fill the human soul, from the highest sort of joy and praise and happiness and thankfulness to the most bleak moments of despair and feeling forsaken, the Psalms give voice to all of those emotions and do them in a way that enables the Christian to know that he's speaking in ways that God approves of. Some of the things in the Psalms are so sort of radical in speaking to God that I think most of us are too pious to say those things left to ourselves. But the Psalter really shows how God encourages us to be honest about our feelings with him. So whether the feelings are high or low or somewhere in between, the Psalter really gives voice to where we are. And that's why it's so important for us to know the Psalter, so that when the bad times come, we know where to turn. When the good times come, we know where to turn to give thanks. And John Calvin had an unusual connection with the Psalms. I think the sufferings of his own life, he felt really were given expression in the Psalms for him personally. So it was a very personal matter for him. And as you know, he wrote this huge five-volume commentary on the Psalms. It engaged a great deal of his preaching and teaching life. And he had clearly fallen in love with the Psalms and turned to them again and again, and provides a great encouragement for us to do the same thing.
I couldn't help thinking that, you know, perhaps it's one of the reasons that much of the church has sort of fallen prey to the health, wealth, prosperity gospel, is just even a lack of understanding of seeing those range of emotions. You know, we have these televangelists saying that Christians must always live in this high moment of happiness and joy and wealth, prosperity, or whatever, but they're missing that full scope of what the Christian life, this side of eternity, looks like.
That's right. And I think even our good hymns, and there are a lot of good hymns, even our good hymns don't usually express the full range of emotions that we find in the Psalter. And so it really is important for individual Christians, and I think for congregations, to recapture a familiarity with the Psalter and an ability to use it to praise God, but also to lament before God and yes, express that range of emotions. It's very important.
Early on, you do give an overview or an exposition of Psalm 14, and you introduce us to the French Huguenots and their love, particularly for Psalm 14. Who were the Huguenots? Why did they love Psalm 14, and why should we?
Well, the French Huguenots were the Calvinists in France, the Reformed Church in France. No one is exactly sure where the word Huguenot comes from, but it came to describe those French Reformed Christians. And one of the great and somewhat forgotten stories of the Reformation is how the Reformed Church in France exploded and grew at a phenomenal pace in the 16th century, so that within the course of a couple of decades, some 3 million Frenchmen were drawn into the Reformed Church. And one of the really important aspects of the life of the Reformed Church were the singing of psalms. John Calvin, in his ministry in Geneva, dedicated himself to producing a complete psalter for singing, and it took him almost his whole life to do that. When you think about sitting down to write tunes that are singable for 150 psalms, and then to produce texts that fit the tunes and yet are faithful to the psalm and are singable, that's a huge undertaking. And Calvin was blessed to find in Geneva a number of composers and a number of poets who were able to work away at that. And it just really struck a chord in several parts of Europe. It did in France, it did in the Netherlands, it did in Hungary. Somehow these tunes and these texts connected with people. And so the singing of psalms in France were a way that French Reformed Christians, in the face of persecution, came to understand themselves. And the little Psalm 114 is a psalm about being strangers in your own land. And I think that's the way the French Reformed Christians, as they were persecuted, felt. What I personally found curious is that when I went back to the tune they sang that psalm to, the tune and the psalm that they loved so much, I find that tune almost unsingable. And so it reminds us how times change, cultures change, tastes change, and it's sort of hard to imagine how that tune became so popular, but it really did. And one of the ways in the days of persecution that French Reformed Christians would testify to their neighbors about their faith is that they would walk through the streets of their towns in the dark singing psalms. And that way they couldn't be recognized, but their testimony could be heard, and it made a very powerful impact on people.
I wasn't saved in a psalm singing church like your story, but I did spend a number of years in a psalm singing congregation, and it was a really rich, edifying time. That was, I think, when I first began to really learn to love the psalms, not realizing that they are songs, and that not only can you read them and preach from them, but that you can sing them as well, and really, you know, bury and treasure God's word in your heart. So it's encouraging, you know, to hear just how the body of Christ in times gone by have used the Psalms, even in song, to really equip and enable them, as you said, to face times of persecution.
Right. And I think probably our viewers today may have had a little experience of that themselves. The one psalm that is still fairly well known broadly in Bible-believing churches is Psalm 23, "The Lord is my shepherd." And we've probably all had the experience. It's a lot easier to memorize Psalm 23 to a tune than it is to memorize it just as a poem on a page. So the music really does aid us in getting the psalm in our hearts and in our minds.
Well, you bring up Psalm 23, so I want to jump to that right now if we can. One moment as I was reading this book that was profound for me was your discussion of the difference between Hebrew poetry and English poetry, and then how that can sort of shift or maybe shine a light on the emphasis of the 23rd Psalm. Would you mind just sharing those differences and how that relates to Psalm 23?
Yes, I think an important feature of Hebrew poetry, you know, I think a fair number of people know that one feature of Hebrew poetry is repetition, so that very frequently Hebrew poetry will repeat a thought from one line to the next to reinforce it and also to have a subtle shift. But another feature of Hebrew poetry, less well known, is the tendency in most, although by no means all, of Hebrew poetry to really put the central thought in the center of the poem. That's different from most English poetry. Most English poetry, the ending is the big finish that maybe makes everything clear. But in Hebrew poetry, very frequently it's the center, the heart of the poem, we might say, that is the truth around which the whole poem revolves. And I think we can see that in a simple way in Psalm 23, because maybe Psalm 23 for some of us has become so familiar that we just take it for granted that it is what it is, and we don't pause to sort of think about it. But when we stand back a little bit and try to analyze Psalm 23, we suddenly discover it actually is made up of parts that may not seem to fit together that well. So it begins by talking about how the Lord is our shepherd, and that certainly is the part that perhaps remains most with us. But then later in that short psalm, we're really talking about the Lord as the victory getter and the Lord as the feast giver. You establish a table before me in the presence of mine enemies, you anoint my head with oil. Here's the celebration of the victory. That seems really rather distant from the image of the Lord as a shepherd. And what unites these disparate poetic images is the center of this psalm, the center that we sometimes miss, because it's expressed in a just really simple little phrase in the middle of verse 4 of the psalm, "For you are with me." And if you see that little sentence in the middle of the psalm as the center, then suddenly everything is coordinated around it. The Lord is my shepherd, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me, for you are with me. You establish a table before me in the presence of mine enemies, because you are with me. So that's what unites the psalm and gives the psalm coherence, is this wonderful, profound truth at the heart of the psalm: the Lord is with us in all the circumstances of life. And that's a great comfort to see that in this very familiar psalm.
I think this is one of the things that I love about this book, is that you're offering very practical ways to open up the Psalms. Just, you know, even that simple explanation of the difference between Hebrew poetry and English poetry just, you know, really did open up a new Psalm 23 for me. And I trust those that read it as well. One of the other things that you mention in the book is helpful to understand, if you want to really dig deep into the Psalms, is that of the great theme of the Psalms and even the subordinate themes under that. What is the great theme of the Psalter, and how does that help us understand what we're reading?
Well, one of the things that's intriguing and also maybe raises questions in people's mind is that in Hebrew, the book of Psalms is entitled the Book of Praises. And that's a wonderful title, but when we actually read Psalms, we discover not all the Psalms are Psalms of praise. So how do the variety of Psalms actually relate to the title of the book? And as I studied it, it seems to me that one of the ways you can answer that question is to say that the Psalter has praise throughout it, but as you move through the Psalter, the theme of praise becomes stronger and stronger. So there's a kind of culmination in praise, particularly in the last five Psalms of the Psalter. But beyond that, I do think we see the great theme of the Psalter, namely God's goodness and unfailing love for the righteous. That's a theme that repeats over and over and over again. And what a comfort that is to the people of God. God's goodness and unfailing love for the righteous. God's love never fails. God's goodness never fails. And that theme is critical in the Psalter. And every time that theme comes up in the Psalter, it evokes from us as his people praise. So the great theme of the Psalter is a celebration of who our God is for his people, and that evokes from his people then the theme of praise. And I think then the connection of that great theme with our response is part of why we have that title for the book as a whole, the Book of Praises. And I think the Psalter is so helpful there because one of the things in the difficulties of life we're tempted to doubt is the goodness of God and the love of God for us. When life is really hard, when we experience significant suffering, the temptation always is to ask, where is God in this? Is God still good? Is God still loving? And part of the end result of studying the Psalter is to see, yes, he is. His love is unfailing for us.
That is a great comfort to the Christian. I want to ask you a question now that you're probably going to have to unpack a little bit because it's not as simple as it might seem. But who is speaking in the Psalms?
That's one of the issues I really wrestled with in my own study of the Psalter and then putting this book together, because sometimes you have a single speaker in the Psalms. You have I speaking, an individual speaking, and sometimes in Psalms you have we speaking, so that Psalms are both for individuals and for groups. In fact, the beginning of every book of the Psalter, there are five books in the Psalter. At the beginning of every book, there's an individual psalm and a collective psalm, so that always voice is given both to individuals and to the group. But as I thought about what it meant that an individual is speaking as a psalm in a psalm, I realized that sometimes we can immediately identify as an individual Christian with the individual voice of the psalm, the Lord is my shepherd. I can identify with that. I don't see any distance there. But other times when the eye speaks, it is not obvious or immediately me who is speaking. Psalm 26, David says, O Lord, judge me in my integrity. And I, as a Christian, sort of have to pause there and wonder, do I fully want God to judge me according to my integrity? I'm even left with the question, what does David mean there? Because David's integrity wasn't always all it might have been. And so it led me to ask, who really is speaking here in the Psalter? And what I concluded is that what we should see is whether it's an individual psalm where I, in quotes, is speaking, or whether it's a communal psalm where we, in quotes, are speaking. In a certain sense, it's always the king who is speaking, both for himself and for his people. And that's why we can enter into every psalm, maybe not directly, but in the person of the king who speaks for us. In the Old Testament, of course, it was David and his sons. But for us, I think in the New Testament, we see even more clearly than they saw, and we see that it's Jesus who's speaking. And in a certain sense, then, in every psalm, we see Jesus speaking. We can look right at the beginning of the Psalter. Blessed is the man who, is always faithful, is avoiding the scoffers, who doesn't sit with the sinners, whose delight is in the law of God. And we may think to ourselves, well, that is sort of true of me. I do try to avoid the scoffers and the sinners. I do try to delight in the law of God. But, you know, it's not as true of me as I'd like it to be. So is this psalm really for me? Is this psalm just expressing an ideal towards which I should press but haven't quite achieved? And the answer is to that, yes, that's true as far as it goes. But there's something even more profoundly true. This is Jesus speaking. He is the one who always avoided the seat of scoffers. He is the one who always delighted in the law of God. And this is his psalm, although it's also my psalm, because I'm in him and I can participate with him. And then you move on to Psalm 2, and there's a great communal celebration of the king that God has set on Zion's hill. And there very much we are seeing Jesus enthroned, and we're experiencing the success that God's people always have in the success of their king. So I do think we should see, on one level, all the psalms as the psalms of the king. Even when, and this is the most problematic moment, of course, even when the king is confessing his sin, and we could say, well, that surely can't be Jesus because he never sinned. But even there, I think these are the words of Jesus, not on behalf of his own personal sin, of which he had none, but because the scriptures tell us he took our sin upon himself. And so he not only bore the penalty for our sin, but he even took up the repenting of our sin for us, because our repentance is never perfect. But when Jesus takes up even the burden of our repenting, then we can know it's perfect and fully received in God's sight. So even there, we can see Jesus speaking for us and acting for us in a wonderful way.
I remember reading in some of the comments on Facebook after we launched this book, and maybe it's a dangerous place to ever be reading the comments on Facebook, but there was a sincere Christian that commented and said, questioned the title of the book, Learning to Love the Psalms. And she said, I don't know any Christian that doesn't love the Psalms. But I think if people listen to what you've just shared, and over the last 30 minutes, highlighting some of the difficulties of how we understand and interpret the Psalms, and dig a bit deeper to know who is speaking in what psalm, and the various meanings that can lie within a particular psalm. I wonder if you can just touch a little bit further on how the Psalms speak beyond David as the King of Israel and point further to Jesus.
Well, I think we're familiar as Christians that the Psalms are interpreted in the New Testament over and over again as being the speech of Jesus. And the writers of the New Testament seem to take that so for granted, it's almost not commented on in a particularly fascinating places in Hebrews chapter 2 where the latter part of Psalm 22 is quoted, where it's talking about Jesus speaking to his brethren in the great congregation. And here Psalm 22 is quoted and put in the lips of Jesus, even though it's David's psalm. But the New Testament sees David, in a sense, always as a prophet, always speaking on behalf of the coming Messiah, so that really the words of the Psalter are put in the mouth of Jesus. We know that when he hung on the cross and cried out, "My God, my God, why have you forsaken me?" Those words are not original to Jesus. He's quoting Psalm 22, verse 1. And again, I think it deepens the significance of that statement by our Savior to realize he's not just taking his own forsakenness on himself, but he's taking our forsakenness upon himself. It was David who first gave voice to the reality of God's people that at times they feel forsaken. And Jesus is bearing all of that, not only his forsakenness, but our forsakenness on the cross. And that's why we need to see the Psalms always in relation to Jesus. There was a minister of the Free Church of Scotland who commented, "We see more of the emotional life of Jesus in the Psalter than anywhere else in the Bible." And I think that's profoundly true. And that's why the New Testament quotes the book of Psalms more, I think, than any other book of the Old Testament, because it doesn't just function as a prophecy of who Jesus will be, although it certainly does that. And we can see that great prophecy, for example, in Psalm 110, where that Jesus quotes to confound the Pharisees and the Sadducees, where David, as a prophet, says in Psalm 110, "The Lord has said unto my Lord, sit thou at my feet until I make thine enemies thy footstool," and then goes on to say, "You are a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek." Well, Jesus stopped the mouth of the Pharisees when he said, "Who is David's Lord? How can David's son be David's Lord?" The Pharisees had no answer for that. But of course, we know the answer to that. Jesus can be David's Lord because he's God's son as well as David's son. So the Psalms do prophesy explicitly of Jesus, but more than that, they always show us the heart of Jesus as God come in the flesh, as the true man who is the true King of Israel for us.
I'm sure you often get asked this question when you're discussing or teaching on the Psalms, but what do we do with the imprecatory Psalms, those calling out for judgment upon our enemies? Are these Psalms that we should be praying, that we should be singing as congregations? How do we handle those particular Psalms? Are they the heart of Jesus?
Well, the brief answer is yes, they are the heart of Jesus. And here again, I think we see an element of the Psalter that's important for the church today, precisely because it's neglected and uncomfortable for the church today. The truth is, the Bible teaches in a very clear, sometimes disturbingly clear way that judgment is coming, and that judgment will be terrible on the wicked, and that this is a truth revealed in Scripture that is meant to be taught and preached and sung about. And the fact that we're uncomfortable about that means that we might need even more to think about it. You might ask as a viewer, how often do you sing a hymn in church about judgment that's coming? Is this a theme that's neglected today? Now, of course, the problem with the imprecations in the minds of some people is you're not just saying there will be judgment, you're praying that judgment will come. And is that appropriate to Christians? And the discussion often is, well, if Jesus says we're to love our enemies, is it loving to our enemies to pray the judgment will come upon them? And that's a very fair question and deserves a fair answer. And I think the New Testament does give us a fair and clear answer to that. We do love our enemies, and we love them and pray for them that they might come to repentance. But we also recognize that our very love for our enemies may one day bring them into greater judgment because they have turned their back on Christ and upon his people and upon the proclamation of the truth. And Paul really discusses that in Romans chapter 12. And he talks about how loving our enemies is a way of bringing down fiery coals upon their head in the day of judgment if they won't listen. Again, that may be somewhat uncomfortable. But when you think about it, every time we pray, "Come quickly, Lord Jesus," in a sense, that's an imprecation. Because when Jesus comes, the day of salvation will be over and the day of judgment will have arrived. And so that prayer, even by itself, is an imprecation. And so the imprecations of the Psalter are never prayers for personal vengeance for us when we're mad at somebody. We enter into the imprecations of the Psalter as the prayers of the king, praying for judgment on enemies of the king and the kingdom. And it's in that sense that they're appropriate. And you know, we do find imprecations in the New Testament. I was recently somewhat surprised that I hadn't noticed before. In 1 Corinthians 16, verse 22, Paul closes that wonderful letter where we have the chapter on love in 1 Corinthians 13. But in 1 Corinthians 16, 22, he says, "If anyone has no love for the Lord, let him be accursed." So right there, Paul is uttering an imprecation because the end of resistance to the Lord and to the truth will be judgment.
You mentioned at the beginning that, you know, what awakened you again, perhaps, to your affection for the Psalms was when you were forced to answer the question, "Do you have a favorite book in the Bible?" And I don't want to push you on this, but do you have a favorite Psalm?
Well, that changes a little bit. Just recently, I've been spending a fair bit of time studying Psalm 68, which is a really challenging psalm to study. One scholar said it's amazingly exuberant and is like a rushing river over cataracts. Its exact poetic form is challenging. The exact direction of its movement is a little bit perplexing at times. Some of its images are wonderfully comforting and others are disturbing. There's a theme of judgment that invites us to come and bathe our feet in the blood of the wicked. That's a little disturbing. And yet there's these wonderful promises of God as the defender of the widow and the father of the fatherless, so that it moves from terrible images of judgment to some of the most intimate expressions of love and care on the part of God. And I think part of what's fascinating right now is a verse at the center of that psalm, which says Sinai has moved to the sanctuary. And in reading some of the commentators, it's interesting, the commentators don't like that verse. They think there's got to be some error there. There's some need to correct the text there. And I think it's exactly what the psalm is all about. The theme of the psalm is the God who met with Israel at Sinai has now led Israel safely through the wilderness and up to the victory of David, so that Jerusalem is now the dwelling place of God. Sinai has come to the sanctuary. It's exactly the movement of God from the wilderness to Jerusalem, to the holy city, to the temple. And for the Christian, we enter into that because the New Testament says we live now in the wilderness, but one day we will be delivered to the heavenly Jerusalem. And indeed, the heavenly Jerusalem will be brought down to earth, the new heaven and the new earth. So it's a psalm that's full of expectation, full of promise, and a challenge to the preacher and to the student. So right now, I'm having a lot of fun with Psalm 68.
If Kelvin is correct that the Psalter is, you know, a full anatomy of the soul, expression of the anatomy of the soul, then, you know, your favorite psalm would change depending on how you're feeling, where you happen to be, you know, with your in your walk with the Lord, and and stuff like that, which is part of the beauty of the Psalter, that there's always a place for you to go wherever you happen to be at that point in time in your life.
Well, that's right. And this psalm is sort of a psalm that talks about the triumph of God's purpose, God's salvation plan for all of his people. So it's a sort of grand scheme psalm, a little like Psalm 2. And then other times you really want something very intimate. When I first began to sign books at Ligonier at conferences, I discovered that all the other people who were signing books had a Bible verse that they wrote down. So I thought, well, you know, I better, you know, go along with the crowd and have my own Bible verse. And I had at that time been studying Psalm 9, which was John Knox's favorite psalm, John Knox, the great reformer of Scotland. And so verse 10 became very precious to me. And those who know your name put their trust in you, for you, O Lord, have not forsaken those who seek you. And I think that's such a wonderfully encouraging psalm. God is there for us. When we seek him, he's there for us. And sometimes, perhaps particularly in Reformed theology, we can so stress the sovereignty of God, the awesomeness of God, that maybe we can lose a little of that stress on the fact that God is still very much there and with us each individually. I do remember, however, having a bad moment at a conference because I hadn't been at a conference in a while. And so a nice young couple came up with a book and asked me to sign it, and I did. And without thinking, I wrote under it Psalm 10, verse 11, instead of Psalm 9, verse 10. Hmm. And as they walked away, I thought, oh, I did that wrong. And I didn't know offhand what Psalm 10, verse 11 actually said. So hoping it was okay, I quickly turned to it, and it says, he says in his heart, God is forgotten. He has hid his face. He will never see it. And I thought, oh, great. So I publicly announced my error to that young couple and urged them to change what I'd written from Psalm 10:11 to Psalm 9:10. So I hope all the viewers will focus on Psalm 9:10.
Well, your discussion of the difference between Hebrew and English poetry, as we mentioned earlier, and how that can change our understanding of the emphasis or focus of Psalm 23. I'm just wondering, as we're coming to a close at our time this afternoon, are there any other psalms where, if a Christian were to understand some of these important tools of interpreting the psalms, that, you know, perhaps it would shine a bit of new light on another psalm?
Well, one of the things we haven't really talked about is the five book structure of the Psalter, and I talk about that at some length in the book. We don't have time to go at that altogether, but I really think there's a movement in the Psalter. So the book one, Psalms 1 through 41, are very much personal psalms about David, his struggles with faith, his difficulties. And then book two, Psalm 42 through 72, are psalms more about David's kingship and about his kingdom. Book three is really the book of crisis. That's where you find some of the most struggling, suffering psalms. And they are at least in part inspired by the exile from the kingdom. And then Psalm 73 through 89. And then book four is the beginning of the pursuit of comfort in the light of loss in the exile, where the Psalms are reflecting particularly on creation and on the Mosaic covenant. That's Psalm 90 through 106. And then the fifth book is sort of a recapitulation of Israel's history and a mounting tide of praise for God's deliverance and provision for his people. So that kind of structure helps us see something of the movement of the Psalter. So in book three, where you expect psalms of suffering, you have Psalm 74, Psalm 77 that are very much psalms of suffering. Psalm 88 is probably the bleakest psalm in the whole Psalter. When you're feeling at your very lowest point, reading Psalm 88 remind you that you're not the only Christian who ever felt alone and abandoned. In that psalm, you have the heart-rending verse, "Darkness is my only companion." Here is real suffering and words given to suffering by the Psalter. But it's intriguing that a book three is obviously the central book of the Psalter. So if centers are important, then book three is important because the Psalter is about bringing us through suffering. And then there's a central psalm in the central book. The central psalm is Psalm 81. And Psalm 81 initially seems a little out of joint with the overall theme of suffering, a little out of joint with book three. And in the center, the very center of Psalm 81, so the central verse of the central psalm of the central book says, "If my people would but listen." And you could say this is a really uniting theme of the whole Psalter. If God's people would only listen to God's word, how different our lives would be, how full of blessing our life would be. So here's a great uniting theme of the Psalter and a great encouragement to meditate on the Psalter and, of course, on the whole word of God to know God's will for us.
There is one sense where the past 45 minutes will have been an answer to this question I'm going to ask you. But if you were to succinctly sum up, what would the church and what would individual Christians be missing out on if we didn't have the Psalter? How would you answer that?
Well, we know as Bible-believing Christians that the whole Bible is the Word of God to us. And we believe that. We know that Bible is without errors and that God speaks fully, clearly, truthfully to us throughout the Bible. The unique thing about the Psalter is, of course, it is too God's word to us, but it is also, and this is true of it alone in a sense, it is also God's word to us to give us words to him. And that's one of the great blessings of the Psalter, that God not only speaks to us, but he gives us words to speak to him. And if we didn't have the Psalter, we would be impoverished in knowing how to speak to him clearly and fully and boldly. I always like to use the example of Psalm 74, where the people of God are really suffering and they're wondering, where is God? And the psalmist says to God in that psalm, "Why are you standing with your hands in your garment?" And if we pause and meditate about that, the psalmist is really saying to God, why are you standing around with your hands in your pockets when there are things that need doing? Well, I don't think I'd say that to God. I wouldn't have the courage to say that to God. But the psalmist says that to God to show that God encourages us to lay out our frustrations to him honestly. And now, not to doubt him, not to despair of him, not certainly to hate him, but to be honest with him. And sometimes we're so frustrated we hardly know what to say, and the Psalter enables us to speak to him, and then of course follows up with wonderful words of comfort and encouragement and strength for us in those struggles.
Well, before I come to a final question for you, Dr. Godfrey, I want to again thank those who are watching live and let them know that if they want to pick up a copy of Learning to Love the Psalms, that they can order a copy from Ligonier.org's online store this week only for 35% off the full list price if they use the coupon code PSALMS35. That's PSALMS, the number 3, the number 5. PSALMS35 to save 35% off the full list price when you place that order at Ligonier.org. And this offer is valid until April 23rd, 2017. Dr. Godfrey, just one final question for you this afternoon. People have been joining in from around the world watching this discussion, and hopefully they'll come back and watch it in the future as well. For someone wanting to crack open the Psalms and have a read this afternoon, tonight, and really want to dig a little bit deeper, in addition to ordering a copy of your new book, what are some practical tips you might offer to them to really help them get the most out of the Psalter and their time of study?
Well, I would say that there are some really helpful things in the book. There's some questions to ask of each psalm as you read it in the book. There's subordinate themes as well as the great theme that you and I talked about, Nathan. But the main thing is to do what the psalms themselves call us to do, and that's meditate on the psalms. I think we are such a busy people. We're always in a hurry, and you can read a psalm quickly and gain something. That's one of the blessings of the psalms. Even a superficial read will have blessings for you. But slow down, meditate on the psalm. Think about, where is Jesus in this psalm? Where am I in this psalm? How is God speaking to me in this psalm? And how is God encouraging me to speak to him in this psalm? Meditation, the word, the call to meditate in Hebrew means to mumble. And the idea was that you roll it around in your mind and in your mouth. You keep looking at it from different angles. You ask questions of the text. Spend time with it. And the more time you spend with it, the more that wonderful things will come to you out of it. I've been speaking in chapel here at Westminster Seminary California, and I've been doing 8 chapel talks on Psalm 105. And I can't tell you what a blessing it's been to me to spend that time. It's only 43, 44 verses in Psalm 105. But I'm finding things I never had noticed by forcing myself to go slower and to look more carefully. And Nathan, thanks for the great job you did in asking me questions, getting me thinking even more about the Psalms. And again, thanks to the viewers who are here. As fun as it is to speak to Nathan, it would be a little pointless for him and me just to talk to one another. We're very thankful that you've been with us today.
Yes, we are. And thank you, Dr. Godfrey, for this book and for lending us your time this afternoon.
Thank you. Hope to talk to you again soon.
And to those that are watching us live, we are grateful that you took time out of your afternoon to join live. And I want to let you know that this is just one of many ways that Ligonier is trying to use new technology to expand the kingdom of God. If you would like to be notified of future live events such as this one, be sure to follow Ligonier Ministries on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, and follow the Ligonier blog, or go to ligonier.org/events, and you'll be able to see an upcoming conference or tour, perhaps in your area. Well, my name's Nathan W. Bingham, and may you continue to grow in your knowledge of God and His holiness.